Hello everyone, and welcome to phyloseminar.org, a project supported by the Society of Systematic Biologists. For this series of three talks, we are hearing from three individuals who have thought a lot about modeling heterogeneity in the substitution process across sites. First, we heard from Andrew Roger, who motivated the need for more advanced models with evidence from deep phylogenetics and introduced the cat models. Then we heard from Nathan Whelan, who advocated a site partitioning approach to handle the same issues. Today, we will hear from Nicolas Lartillot, who will describe Dirichlet process mixture models for site heterogeneity in detail. I remind you that the Q&A app is gone now, so you can ask questions through Twitter or IRC as described in the attending section of the phyloseminar website. As I mentioned, today's speaker is Nicolas Lartillot. Nicolas started his education in physics at the ENS in Paris, started doing biology, cloning and sequencing, and then got a PhD in André Adut's lab working on experimental embryology. He then went to Hervé Philippe's lab at the University of Montreal for a postdoc and landed a permanent position in Montpellier for 4 years. After that, he went back to the University of Montreal as an assistant professor, then returned to France, this time to University of Lyon. He currently holds the title of CNRS Research Director. Welcome, Nicolas, and thanks for participating.
Thank you, Eric. So I will essentially present the models that have been implemented in PhyloBase, so the CAT and the CAT-GTR models. This in the context of the recent controversies that have been taking place recently over the animal phylogeny. So these controversies mostly concern two specific groups, Xenae coelomorphs and ctenophores. For the remaining of this talk, I will only talk about ctenophores. So concerning ctenophores, the classical view of the animal phylogeny is that sponges are the sister group to all other animals, including ctenophores. And then the specific position of ctenophores here is not totally certain. More recently, over the last 2 years, an alternative hypothesis has been proposed in several publications, suggesting that ctenophores might actually be the sister group to all other animals. So I should say here that ctenophores have muscle cells and a nervous system, unlike sponges, but like Nilarians and Bilaterians. And therefore, this ctenophore sister hypothesis would imply either a secondary loss in sponges or independent evolution of the nervous system, ctenophores, and Nilarians and Bilaterians. So all these analyses have been conducted in the context of a supermatrix analysis using concatenation of genes. And all of them also have used mostly amino acid sequences. So they basically share this methodological paradigm. And the differing results that they get, in fact, mostly depend on the underlying model of sequence evolution that have been used. And more specifically, how this model deal with pattern heterogeneity across sites along the sequence. So essentially, across all of these analyses, you have three different levels of models. First, you have global models that don't account for pattern heterogeneity across sites. So they do account for overall variation in the overall rate of substitution across sites, but they assume the same amino acid replacement process across all of the sites. And typically, those models use empirical matrices such as WAG or LG. Then you have gene level models that allow for different genes to have different amino acid replacement process. And a more specialized version of these gene level models is to essentially try to partition clustered genes into different groups and then apply the same model to all of the genes of a given group. And a specific implementation of this is provided by the combination of two programs, RaxML and Partition Finder. Partition Finder for finding the partitions and then RaxML for estimating the partition. And then you have more fine-grained models that try to account for pattern heterogeneity directly across sites, including within genes. And in the context of those metazoan phylogenetic analyses, the two models that have been used most often are the CAT-GTR and the CAT model, the CAT-F81 models. So those models are Bayesian And they use Dirichlet process priors to implement this variation process. So three different levels, but in fact, the main difference, the dividing line, if you wish, is in fact between the site models, so the CAT and CAT-GTR models on one side, and then the partition and the global models on the other side. Basically, what happens is that sponge sister is something that you get only under the Dirichlet process model, so the models that account for site heterogeneity. And so we need to understand what's happening here. And so I have developed those models myself. And so I have developed them fundamentally because I think that accounting for pattern heterogeneity across sites is really important in the context of phylogenetic estimation. Now I can see also that those Dirichlet process methods are a rather complicated statistical methodology. And so the main point of my talk, the main objective, would be to try to give you a more methodological perspective on those models and try to give you some intuition as to how they work exactly. So basically, I will first give a rapid motivation of why I think that modeling pattern heterogeneity across sites, including within genes, is important. But then I will mostly focus on those Dirichlet process approaches, and I will try to explain what they mean exactly, statistically speaking, and how they work in practice, using in particular simulations. And then I will come back to the TINO4 problem, and I will look at simulation experiments. I will show you simulation experiments to assess the phylogenetic accuracy of those methods compared to more classical models. So, as a way to motivate the argument, I would like to come back to an experiment that we have conducted together with Hervé Philippe and Henner Brinkmann back in 2007, which can be seen as a way to test the robustness of phylogenetic models against systematic errors. So here you have a data set with 41 taxa and about 18,000 amino acid positions. And you see, I apply the WAHAG model, so the global model, assuming homogeneity in the substitution pattern across sites, plus the gamma distribution of rates. And then I get a phylogeny that gives nematodes together with arthropods, and both of them sister group to deuterostomes. So this is congruent with the ichthyosaur hypothesis. But then I remove those species here, cnidarians and coanoflagellates, which are the closest outgroup to bilaterians in the present case, and I redo the analysis. And then what I get is strong support in terms of posterior probability for nematodes now being sister group to deuterostomes and arthropods, which is then essentially compatible with the old coelomate hypothesis. So you see, basically, the idea is to challenge the models by playing with taxon sampling and putting them in more challenging situations and see if they are able to be to fight or to see they are robust against long branch attraction artifacts. And so in that case, we see that no, the model is actually sensitive to that and makes a systematic error. And so this is true for the WAG model, but this is true for any model that relies on a single amino acid replacement matrix for all sites. And then it's also true if you use gene-level partition models, you get the same result. So this is actually a typical case of a long branch attraction artifact. So you have two long branches here, nematodes, fast evolving, and fungi, a distant outgroup. But then the branch that unites nematodes and arthropods is short. And for that reason, you don't get many sites in your alignment that are informative for the true phylogeny. On the other hand, because those two branches are long, quite a few sites will make independent substitution events along those two branches, and some of them will land on the same amino acid in nematodes and in fungi, and therefore they will be misleadingly informative for the artifactual phylogeny. And so you see this argument clearly points to an inherent asymmetry of the situation where you end up with more site patterns that are misleading than site patterns that are actually informative. And the only way you can fight this inherent asymmetry is by having a model that is able to correctly offset this and to correctly evaluate the probability to get such convergent site patterns in the first place. And that's the way those models will be robust against long branch attraction artifacts. Now, we are dealing with amino acid sequences. And therefore, we might think that the probability of getting the same amino acid just by chance in two unrelated species would be low, like of the order of 1 over 20. But in practice, it's actually not the case. If you look at different site patterns that you can see, and if you try to map them on a phylogenetic tree, you can easily find sites that are fast evolving, but then they are making repeated substitution events between very few different amino acids, like here between essentially 3 amino acids for the 2 sites I show here. And so this has a bearing on the problem that we are dealing with right now. You can see that it's fundamental if you want to correctly estimate the probability of convergent evolution in two different species at a given site, and therefore be able to correctly discriminate between the signal and the noise, basically, which is source of artifact, then you have to correctly anticipate this pattern of repeated convergent evolution within a very restricted set of amino acids. The way the classical matrix models do this is by implementing high exchange rates between amino acids that are biochemically equivalent. However, this doesn't work so well, and I can show you here an example, for instance, of 2 sites, both of which accept isoleucine, but then one of them will make repeated substitution events towards leucine, and the other one will make repeated substitution events between isoleucine and valine. And so you see that you have different sites here that have different but overlapping orbits in the state space, in the 20 amino acids. But then you can imagine that if you try to estimate a global amino acid replacement matrix over many sites that have those patterns and other patterns still, then essentially you will average out those effects and we get a matrix that will essentially give moderate values of exchanges between all possible amino acids. And in particular, starting from an isoleucine, you will get then a high likelihood to make changes to leucine or valine for any site. And so if you actually simulate site patterns under those matrices, what you see typically is site patterns that very quickly spread over many amino acids, not stay within like 2 or 3 amino acids over many repeated substitution events. This is something that you can actually quantify by essentially looking at the summary statistic that calculates the mean number of different amino acids per colon in your line. So typically the mean diversity, as I call it, is small, of the order of 3 or a bit less. And then you can just calculate this for the true data, but you can also fit your model and then resimulate under the posterior predictive formalism, resimulate data under your best estimate of the parameters or under the posterior distribution. And then you can look at the distribution of mean diversity that you get over your simulation replicates. And you see here that typically, like the models that use one single amino acid replacement matrix across the whole alignment will tend to produce data sets that have too many amino acids per column. So they don't reproduce the low diversity per site that we see in true alignments. So that's one thing. And the other thing is just to show you how important the site-specific effects can be, we've made this little experiment using toy models. So basically we use Jukes-Cantor models. In the first setting, we use a Jukes-Cantor model that is just a classical Jukes-Cantor with 20 amino acids over the whole alignment. And then in this context, we get basically the artifact. So depending on the choice of the group, we can get nematodes, a sister group to deuterostomes, and arthropods. We can get the coelomate artifact. In contrast, if now I use different Jukes-Cantor matrices across sites, such that the Jukes-Cantor matrix at a given site plays only among the amino acids that are actually observed at that site. It essentially amounts to giving a probability of 0 to all unobserved amino acids. If I do this and I redo the analysis, then I don't get the artifact. I get nematodes together with arthropods. So of course, this is not a statistically legitimate way to proceed, but at least it shows that in principle, like helping the model to basically understand that you have few amino acids per site, and therefore you have mechanically a very high probability of convergence substitution at a given site, typical site. Just doing that is sufficient to get rid of this artifact. Whereas in contrast, like partition models or classical empirical matrices don't get rid of this artifact. But then we need to do it in a proper way. So essentially what we need is to model variation in the equilibrium frequencies over the 20 amino acids across sites. And then we can combine this with relative exchange rates, which will be essentially assumed to be global along the whole sequence. And then those exchange rates can be estimated on the data set. And this is essentially the paradigm of the CAT-GTR model. Or we can make a further simplification, which looks a little bit like the Jukes-Cantor experiment I've just shown, where essentially you assume that you have flat exchange rates among amino acids. So this is a rather a brutal assumption, simplification, but it turns out to be computationally very efficient. And that's fundamentally the reason why this model, CAT-F81, has been developed. But in any case, so we need to have a proper way of dealing with those site-specific amino acid profiles. So in summary, there are obviously strong site-specific effects that are due to selection, and that those effects imply strong restrictions in the kinds of amino acids that are allowed at each site, and in the number of amino acids that are allowed at each site. And this mechanically leads to a high probability of convergent evolution. And site homogeneous models or partition models at the gene level do not correctly account for that. And therefore, we need to make models that account for those site-specific effects. Now, how can we do this? Formally, site-specific amino acid frequency profiles is the same thing as site-specific rates, like rates across sites. It's just a different parameter that happens to be 20-dimensional, but otherwise conceptually it's the same thing. So we could look at how we model rates across sites and try to get some intuition as how we can generalize this to equilibrium frequency profiles. So how do we model rates across sites then? So we don't know the rates at each site, and we can't maximize the likelihood with all of those rates. That would be overfitting. And therefore, what we do then is we assume that at each site, the rate is itself a random variable that is drawn from some distribution. And usually we take the gamma distribution, which will then be the distribution of rates across sites. So this distribution has a mean 1 because we are talking about relative rate of evolution. And then the variance is tuned by a parameter, the shape parameter, which is usually called alpha. And so then rates are random, and therefore at a given site, the likelihood now is an average of the likelihood over all possible values of the rate integrated over this gamma distribution. And this integral is usually discretized for computational reasons. And then we can make the product over all sites. And this gives us a likelihood that depends on the tree, on the parameters of the model, and also on this shape parameter. Now this likelihood, we can combine it with a prior, or we could actually maximize this likelihood with respect to the parameters. That's what's been done early on with those models. But we can also combine this likelihood with a prior, and then we get a posterior distribution on the parameters, including on alpha. Now, what about the true distribution of rates across sites? We don't have any reason to believe that this is necessarily a gamma distribution. Here I show you like a representation, a bit naive representation, but this is for making a point, a very important point about the parametric versus non-parametric models. Essentially, the plane represents the space of all possible distributions of rates across sites. And here, this is the true distribution, which I call F star. And then we have this line here that corresponds to the whole continuum of gamma distributions that you can get by playing with the value of the alpha parameter. And so essentially we put a prior, we use a parametric model. And so essentially we put a prior on alpha, which means we are putting a prior only along this line. And then our posterior distribution is somehow concentrated somewhere along this line where we are closest to the true distribution, but still, you see, there is a mismatch here. It's a potential violation of the pattern. And this could in principle, create problems. But usually we consider that this is good enough, at least for greater crop size. So how can we generalize this idea to profiles across sites now, amino acid profiles? So first we need to have an equivalent of the gamma distribution. For frequency vectors, we can use the Dirichlet distribution, which is parameterized by a vector of weights. So for amino acids, we have 20 weights, then beta is a vector of 20 dimensions. So those weights essentially tune the mean and the variance of the distribution, the Dirichlet distribution. I should say here that the Dirichlet distribution is not the same thing as the Dirichlet process, which I will introduce later on. We should keep this in mind. So then we have a parametric distribution we could use for making a parametric model allowing for variation in amino acid profiles across sites. And now it's the same as for rates. So we can, for a given site, average the likelihood over all possible equilibrium frequency profiles of amino acids under this Dirichlet distribution, and then take the product of all sites. We can combine this likelihood with a prior, and this gives us a posterior distribution. And we could sample from this posterior distribution, except that we need to calculate this integral, and it's actually difficult. And here we cannot use the discretization trick that was used for the gamma distribution because it's a multidimensional effect, 20 dimensional. And so discretization would imply too many discretization points, basically. Instead, what we can do though is just let the MCMC take care of this integral for us by essentially co-sampling the site-specific profiles along with the other parameters. And in the end, what we get then is an expanded posterior distribution that also includes the vectors. That also includes the vector of site-specific profiles. And this is actually mathematically equivalent in terms of the marginal posterior distribution over trees, as if we were able to do that. Now again, the true distribution might actually be arbitrary complex. And there is no reason to believe that this parametric model would be sufficient. And actually this would be perhaps an even more fundamental problem here compared to rates across sites, because it's a multidimensional effect. And selection can play in very complex ways on the exact profiles that you get across sites. As a motivating example, I've made a simulation experiment where I've used as the true distribution, which I call G star, a mixture of 9 Dirichlet densities that is used in the context of profile agents. And then I've made a simulation where I use Y exchange rates, but I draw those site-specific amino acid frequency profiles from this true distribution, G star. And then I simulate over a tree and apply the parametric model I just introduced. So here I give you a few examples of profiles that can be drawn from this distribution here. You can see that they look relatively reasonable biochemically speaking. Then I need a way to visualize distributions of amino acid profiles across sites, which is not easy. So what I use here is a summary statistic. Actually, two different summary statistics, which will be convenient for just displaying one-dimensional projections of those distributions. So the two statistics are first, the hydrophobicity, the mean hydrophobicity of the profile, which is essentially the average hydrophobicity over the 20 amino acids weighted by the frequencies such as defined by the profile. So this is hydrophobic, you have a higher hydrophobicity index, you have a low hydrophobicity index here. And then the second summary statistic is the effective number of amino acids for this profile. So essentially the size of the state space of the substitution process, which is important for us in the context of what I've explained about the probability of conversion substitutions. So then I can use one of those summary statistics. Here I use the hydrophobicity index and I can display the distribution that is induced by this G star distribution over the hydrophobicity index. So here, this is G star, basically, the true distribution that I've used to making the simulation, for making the simulation. And there I show you the cumulative distribution function corresponding to this distribution. It's just a convenient one-dimensional projection. So I make simulation and then I reanalyze using the Dirichlet parametric model. And this is what I get. So this is, in blue, my best estimate, basically, my posterior mean estimate of the distribution of amino acid profiles across sites. And you can see that this is definitely very different from the true distribution that was used here. So basically, we are definitely far from the true distribution. And we are confined within this parametric family, and that's fundamentally the problem. And so this motivates actually the argument that we could perhaps use a non-parametric method. So instead of making this parametric assumption, and so by design, be restricted within this manifold representing the parametric family, instead, in the Bayesian context, what we would like to do is basically define a prior over the whole space of all possible distributions of amino acid profiles across sites, and a prior that would cover, in particular, the true distribution, but that would be centered on our parametric family that can be seen as our first guess situation. And then combining this prior with the likelihood, using the usual Bayesian principles, we should, hopefully at least, we should get a posterior distribution over the distribution space that would be concentrated in the vicinity of the true distribution. Then using increasingly large data sets, and if you have good asymptotic properties, then we should have a posterior distribution that gets more and more concentrated around the true distribution. So in this way, we might actually be able to estimate the true distribution, whatever it is, and without any parametric assumption about its shape, basically. How can we do that? So as it turns out, it's impossible to define a prior density over the space of all possible distributions, because this space is basically too large. It has an uncountably infinite number of dimensions. But we can define a prior over the set of discrete distributions, so essentially mixtures, infinite or finite mixtures, but discrete distributions. And those discrete distributions are dense in the space of all possible distributions, in the sense that any arbitrary distribution can be approximated arbitrarily well by a mixture if this mixture is sufficiently rich and sufficiently fine-grained. It's just a pixelization argument, if you wish. And so basically what we'll do, in fact, using Dirichlet processes is define a prior over the space of distribution, but which is somehow pixelized and visits only the discrete distributions, the infinite mixtures. So to start with, we will try to design a prior that is centered on one single parametric distribution, which I will call G0, and it's usually called the base distribution of the Dirichlet process, and we will use our best parametric estimate. So how can we then make a prior around G0? We can define this prior by specifying how we would draw from this prior. And we can draw as follows. Consider first weights of the distribution. So consider a stick of length 1 and draw a random number x1 between 0 and 1. And this defines the first breakpoint. And then the left part will be your first weight. And then the right part will be the what remains, basically. And so you draw now a second random number between 0 and 1. And this defines your second weight. And then you draw a third number. And this defines the third weight, and so on, and so on, and so on. And this goes infinitely. And then you get an infinite series of weights that by construction will sum to 1. And then you can also draw an infinite series of amino acid profiles from the base distribution G0, and you can just combine them together, and that makes an infinite mixture, which can be displayed here. So each spike corresponds to an amino acid profile. It's the hydrophobicity index, and the weight is the height. So you have a distribution here. This distribution G is essentially drawn from a Dirichlet process centered on G0, and with a parameter here that corresponds to the distribution for drawing those random numbers xk's. I will come back to this later. So G is a distribution. And so in particular, if you want to calculate the average likelihood at a given site, then you just need the integral over this distribution is just the weighted sum of the likelihood for all of the profiles. Then G is also a random distribution, because we've drawn it randomly using this stick breaking approach. And we can actually write down the probability of drawing a particular configuration of this discrete distribution. So here I should say actually that for practical reasons, we usually consider a truncated distribution. So basically we make this stick breaking process up to 1,000 components or 5,000 depends. but I will consider 1,000 before. And so here we are making simply, if we want to calculate the probability of drawing a particular configuration, a particular distribution G, then it's just the product of the draws of those XKs that define the weights, and then the product of the densities of all of the profiles that have been drawn from G0. So this defines basically the prior over G. So then this distribution, you can also look at it in terms of its cumulative distribution function. And you can see that this is essentially, it can be seen as a deviation from G0, a random deviation. You can make several draws like this. Now let's come back to the stick breaking process and let's be more specific about how we draw those XKs. Fundamentally, we draw them from a beta distribution of parameter 1 and kappa. So on average, XK will be equal to 1 over 1 plus kappa, which means that if you use larger values of kappa, then you will break the stick small bits at a time. And so doing this, you will get distributions that will essentially be split into more major components, and they will be more fine-grained. You can see this. This means that they are less steppy, and they can make more subtle shapes in terms of the cumulative distribution. So you can draw quite a few of them there, and you can see that indeed they are essentially centered on G0. So a given draw can be seen in this representation as a point away from G0. You can make many such draws, and this basically defines our prior over the space of all possible distributions. And now if we combine this prior with a prior over the beta parameter, which is then we will try to get to use a sufficiently broad prior, then we are essentially sliding along this line, and this gives us the prior we wanted to have, that is essentially centered on the manifold itself. So this is basically the idea. Now we need to make an MCMC sampling strategy in this context. So we can apply Bayes' theorem. So now Bayes' theorem runs on the parameters of the model, including the tree, but also the distribution itself. So the discrete distribution GE is now a parameter of the model. And so the posterior distribution is essentially proportional to the likelihood multiplied by the prior. As I said, the likelihood is product of all sites, and for each site, we make the average over the distribution, the likelihood. And then the prior is just what I've specified earlier in terms of the independent draws of the XKs and the pi k's. In principle, we could make a Metropolis Hastings algorithm that would run over this relatively complex parameter configuration, but we have this problem that for each site, we need to make this sum over 1,000 components. That's not convenient. But again, we can let the MCMC take care of this sum for us by basically sampling also the allocation of all of the sites to one of the components of the mixture. And this amounts to expanding our parameter vector so as to include now this allocation vector. And so in the end, we just need to account for the weight of being allocated to a particular component. And so in the end, this is what we end up doing in terms of MCMC. And this is what makes the Dirichlet process look like a random site partition model, basically. So we will be sampling across all possible ways to cluster sites into a variable number of site classes. And that's what we see when we do MCMC using Dirichlet processes. But I really want to emphasize that the primary meaning of those Dirichlet processes is in terms of prior over distribution space. It is fundamentally a non-parametric method for estimating a distribution. It's not in itself a method for clustering sites and for trying to estimate a meaningful classification of the site patterns. And in fact, it doesn't work so well in this direction. So this is really an important aspect. We should perhaps not have this too much category-centered view on the Dirichlet process, and we should go back to its primary meaning. That's the way it has been invented by Ferguson, actually, as a prior over the space of all possible distribution of random effects across sites. In the present case, a prior over all possible distributions of amino acid profiles across sites. So here I show you an example. So on the simulated data, I've run GAGTR, and then I just show you here. So first, the number of site classes that are sampled by KGTR at equilibrium is about 2,000. It's a very large number. And if you look at different samples from the posterior distribution at different generations of the MCMC, what you see here is that you have a very rich mixture indeed. And probably like very many of those components will be very different between different points of the posterior distribution. And so it's very difficult to make sense of those alternative clustering schemes. If you try to look at them that way, you have the impression that this model is doing like overly rich clustering. But in fact, if you look at the induced cumulative distribution functions, you see that first, they look relatively similar. Second, they look very similar to the true distribution that they are trying to estimate, which is good news. It means that we are estimating the true distribution. And then also you can see that, of course, if you want to have such a close fit with the true distribution, then you need your mixture to be very rich. And in as much as the data set is sufficiently large to allow you to do that, then the system will automatically try to find the value of kappa, basically, so the graininess of the Dirichlet mixture that will allow you to, that will afford, for, that you can afford in order to correctly estimate this distribution. And so then you can pull off of your samples from the posterior distribution and then get a point estimate for the unknown distribution of amino acid profiles across sites in blue here, projected on the hydrophobicity index against the true distribution. So you see it's a relatively reasonable method that is able to estimate an arbitrary distribution. And then you also have a credible band that you can display in terms of the cumulative distribution. Now what happens if you use KGTR on simulations that have been conducted using actually a true distribution that is a finite mixture made of very few components? Like here, 10 components in the case I've simulated here. So if you run KGTR and you look at the posterior number of site classes, the NMOG field of the trace plot, basically, then you get something in that case, which is of the order of 15. So basically you overestimate the number of components of the mixture. It's the way you would naively interpret that. But in fact, if you look at a random sample from the posterior distribution, you see that in fact you have 10 components that count for most of the weight. And then you have a certain number of little components that don't contribute very much. And also if you look at the induced cumulative distribution function, you see that it fits very closely to the true distribution. So basically, it's just that essentially KGTR is giving you an perhaps unnecessarily complicated account of a simple distribution that happens to be a mixture with few components. But in for all practical means, what it does is just correct. And conversely, you can see that if you really want to do that for arbitrary distributions with potentially like different amino acids profiles for every site of your alignment, then you need to have a method that has to be fine-grained in principle. So summary number two, you see the problem is that we need to account for variation, site-specific variation in amino acid profiles across sites. Now those profiles are unknown, so they should be treated as random effects across sites. But then random effects drawn from a distribution which is itself unknown, so we should somehow have a robust way to estimate this unknown distribution. That's why we are using a non-parametric method. We don't want to make parametric assumptions for estimating that. And so really, the fundamental meaning of Dirichlet process is as priors over distribution space, not clustering method. And the number of site classes is perhaps not a meaningful quantity to consider. And so globally, you can see that it's a relatively well-behaved method in the context of simulations. And I don't have time to give you more specific points there, but it's also statistically well-justified on theoretic grounds. Basically, you have asymptotic consistency in the weak topology for estimating. Now, let's come back to real data. So here, it's an application on the case of nematodes, so the case I've shown earlier. This is the projection, so the hydrophobicity index, the distribution of the hydrophobicity index across sites induced by the application of KGTR on the nematode dataset. And so you see that there is extensive variation across sites detected in that case. If we look at the other summary statistic, the effective number of amino acids per site, we see that many sites have equilibrium frequency profiles that imply that those sites are repeatedly substituting within a restricted subset of amino acids, 3, 4, 5. And so now we know that this has a bearing on the problem of phylogenetic accuracy. We can have the hope here that the model would be better and would behave a bit like the restricted Jukes-Cantor model that I have shown earlier. And indeed, if you make the experiment with those CAT and KGTR models, then essentially, with or without the closed-out groups, you always get nematodes together with arthropods. So you have a robustness against this particular long branch extraction artifact. And there are other cases where we can see that those models can have this, this robustness. You can reproduce this also with Plattie-Hellmann's, and there are also published cases, in particular chordates, for which CAT and KGTR find a monophyly of chordates in a situation where actually cephalochordates was together with the echinoderms. So now that we've seen this, we can come back to the problem of genophores. And so in the case of genophores, again, as I said in the introduction, the cat models, both of them, tend to give sponge sister to all other animals and not genophore sister. In contrast to partition models and global site homogeneous models. So here I show you two cases on the data set of Ryan and Al, Ryan and collaborators and Wellan collaborators. This is cat F81, this is cat GTR. This is published in PNAS, was published last year. So by making an analogy with the case of nematodes, it's quite tempting to interpret this in those terms. Like basically, genophores would be a victim of a long branch traction artifact. They might normally belong to this subgroup, but then because this branch is short, because they are fast evolving, if you use a model that doesn't count for heterogeneity across sites in amino acid profiles, in the end, to get genophores, sister group to all of them. That's basically my interpretation of those results. I should say here that, well, you get these phylogenies, but only under specific conditions with CAT and KGTR. In particular, you need to use only the closest out groups. So there are some problems there. So there is additional evidence suggesting that CAT and KGTR are essentially going in the correct direction, and that genophore sister might actually be an artifact. The fact that those two models have a higher feedback cross-validation, and the fact that also these two models are the only one to be congruent with gene content analyses that have been conducted by Walker Pett, and that are also published in this article. So you can have all of the details here. I don't have too much time now to develop on these points. And on the other hand, as I just said, the results that we get with CAT and KGTR are not so clear. We can easily get genophore sister group to other animals, depending on the exact choice of the outgroup. Also, as pointed out by Nathan Wellan a few weeks ago, the model comparison conducted in that case and in many other previous cases doesn't include partition models. And this is definitely something that could be further explored. And then, I mean, Nathan has done a very good point, has made a very good point a few weeks ago by suggesting that we should make more validation of those models using simulations. And I think this is a really important point that needs to be considered. Now, now concerning those simulations that have been presented by Nathan Wellan, I would like to come back to them and to essentially give also my own interpretation of what they mean. Basically, the main results, if I can summarize them, are that KGTR and partition model on those simulations turn out to be just as accurate for the estimation of the topology. Then CAT F81, on the other hand, is inaccurate. But in fact, if you look at those results, and if you look at specifically at the posterior probability support, you don't see any incorrect group that has a posterior probability support at 0.95. So what it means basically is that CAT FT1 essentially tends to give excessively low support for clades, including clades that are correct. And so basically it has too much variance and doesn't make actual systematic errors. So it doesn't give you incorrect groups with a strong statistical support. There is another point concerning those simulations. First, the fact that in all of them, CAT GTR and partition models, except in a few cases, they tend to give the same results. And also, you tend to have a high probability support for all of your clades, even in those cases where the simulated data are small. And this is not what you see with true data. So it seems that there is some distance between the data that have been simulated here and the true data. And in fact, if you look at the, so if you apply the KGTR model on the data simulated by Wana, here is what I show. This is the distribution of amino acid profiles across sites inferred by this by KGTR compared to what you infer on the TINO4 data set, for instance. So you see here that basically those simulations have been conducted with insufficient levels of pattern heterogeneity. I should emphasize here that this is a case where I've used one of the simulations that does include heterogeneity within genes. But still, you see that this heterogeneity has a very low levels. And so this basically motivated me to make a new round of simulations with a more particular focus on the TINO4 problem and trying to implement higher levels of pattern heterogeneity across sites and trying to calibrate actually the amount of pattern heterogeneity I will simulate across sites based on what we can estimate on true data. Because we've seen that KGTR can correctly estimate the true distribution in those simulation contexts, so we can take what KGTR estimates on true data as a good starting point to essentially re-simulate under reasonable levels of heterogeneity across sites. And that's the overall methodology then. I use this data set, day 16, as a template, just for the gene boundaries and the missing data. And then I will simulate under the two trees, either Sponge's system or TINO4 system. I will implement the same process of variation in exchangeabilities across genes as what Nathan did for its own simulations. So basically assigning randomly five matrices such as YAG and JTT across genes. But then I will combine this with amino acid equilibrium frequency profiles, which will be either global across the whole alignment, exactly as in wild simulations, or by using site-specific amino acid frequency profiles, such as estimated by KGTR on this alignment. And then I reanalyze all of those simulations using LG, the partition model such as implemented in RaxML Partition Finder, and then the two CAT models, CAT-F81 and CAT-GTR. And I've made like 10 replicates for all of the simulation experiments. So first, as a control, what happens if I simulate without pattern heterogeneity within genes. So if I essentially have a single amino acid equilibrium frequency profile over the whole alignment, you see basically all of the models always infer the correct phylogeny, 10 out of 10. And this is true whether you simulate under the TINO4 system or under the Sponge's system configuration. Now what happens on those simulations that do include pattern heterogeneity within genes? Here what you get is this. So if you simulate under TINO4 system, again, all of the models find TINO4 system. Now, if you simulate under Sponge's system, then the global model, the site homogeneous model, but also the partition model find always TINO4 system and always with a strong bootstrap support, a high bootstrap support. So basically the site homogeneous and partition models are making an artifact that puts TINO4 sister group to all other animals, exactly as what we see in the true situation. In this situation, CAT-F81 and CAT-GTR find Sponge's sister, so they are robust against this long branch traction artifact. Not 10 out of 10, but in fact, those three and two cases correspond to situation where there is a lack of support for anything. So if you look only at those supports that are higher than 95, you essentially always, you either get Sponge's sister or you don't get any firm decision. So basically, last summary, my take on wildland simulation is that first, you need to correctly understand what's happening with CAT-F81. Essentially, you have low support, but you don't have systematic errors. And also, those simulations perhaps don't implement sufficient levels or sufficiently high levels of pattern heterogeneity across sites. And so actually, they might not capture the most important points that we want to address in the present case. On the other hand, if you make simulations with higher levels of site heterogeneity, then you can see that one matrix and partition models make an artifact. And now it's not just low support, it's strong support for a non-parametric. And in this context, CAD and CAGTR correctly infer the tree topology. Now there are additional experiments, but I have no time to show them. In particular, if I simulate under an even more complex model that is directly specified at the level of the column process, and using arguments based on population genetics theory, then in this context, actually CAD and CAGTR also fail, and they also give TNO4 sister artifact. So they actually can fail, and that's what we see in the true situations. But importantly, they fail always in the same direction. So they can get TNO4 sister as an artifact in a situation where actually the true tree is sponge sister, but there is absolutely no instance where you simulate under TNO4 sister and you would get artifacts sponge sister. So this clearly suggests that we are in a situation where we have this inherent asymmetry between sponge sister and TNO4 sister. Basically, TNO4 sister is right in the middle of the Felsenstein zone. It's the tree, it's the long branch, a track tree. Doesn't mean that it is necessarily incorrect, but this means that if you are using really simple models and you get that, this could well be due to an artifact. So, conclusions now. So you've seen most of the arguments I've tried to develop, trying to convince you that modeling pattern heterogeneity across sites is really important in the context of those phylogenetic reconstructions at large evolutionary scale. For metazoans, but of course this will be true for eukaryotes and the tree of life. And this actually might be true also at smaller evolutionary scales like arthropods, for instance. And so ignoring it clearly leads to phylogenetic artifacts. And in this respect, the case of TNO4s is quite interesting. I think it's one of the most difficult current phylogenetic problems. But then I think there is no hope that you can correctly infer the position of TNO4s if you don't account for pattern heterogeneity across sites. It's not sufficient, but at least it is necessary. Now, modeling pattern heterogeneity across sites is clearly challenging because essentially, if you want to do it the statistically correct way, then you have to implement this in terms of random effects across sites, but these are multidimensional random effects with an unknown and potentially complex distribution. And that's why we end up with those Dirichlet process models that require sophisticated MCMC, and then all this is computationally intensive. And I can see, of course, that in the end, this might actually be a problem for practical reasons. If you want to do analysis on large data sets, then if it takes a long time to get convergence, and if often you also get mixing problems, and you do get those problems with the current implementation of phylogenetic. I can see, of course, those problems. But I don't think that those things are arguments to continue basically the business as usual and continue to use partition models and site homogeneous models, given that they don't correctly account for one of the most striking features of true protein sequence alignments. What it means instead for me, basically, is that more work is needed, and by other people, on site heterogeneous models. So there has been a lot of work being done already in this direction, I should say. I have not mentioned all of this work in this talk, essentially by lack of time. But mostly on the side of finite mixture models, a lot of things have been. But we need to do more things and perhaps bolder things. We also need independent implementations, I think, of those directly processed models. And then it's interesting to, I think it's important actually to explore alternative statistical strategies that would be computationally more efficient. And in this direction, I know that quite a few people are working now, and Andrew Roger, a few weeks ago, has actually presented very interesting and very promising developments. So I would like to thank you for your attention and thank all of those people who have worked a lot on those problems, in particular on TNO4s. And thank you for your attention, and I would be very happy to take questions.
Thank you very much, Nicola. That was a very literate and interesting and sophisticated talk. So I want to remind people that I'm monitoring the Phyloseminar Twitter channel if you want to ask a question, where you can also ask on IRC, and there's a link to the IRC site if you want to ask a question there from the Phyloseminar site. So, I mean, you did you know, say that there's sort of no excuse for trying to you know, in the efficiency isn't quite a good excuse for using simpler models. But I mean, what sort of practical advice would you give people who are sort of running into the computational limitations of Phylo Bayes? And you've also presented how if you cut down the set of sequences that you're using and you're missing sort of intermediate taxa, that also causes problems. So have you thought about you know, ways in which people could sort of approximately do a better job, or you have any thoughts in that regard?
Oh, yes, I have. Well, I have many thoughts in terms of, because I regularly get also people come to me and ask, what could I do there? Because this is problematic. Right now, I think a reasonable direction to take is try to perhaps play data quality instead of data quantity as much as possible. And you see, it's better to analyze smaller data sets with good models than analyze larger data sets with poor models. I think that is, at least this is my personal impression. I think, so I'm working a lot on development right now, and I think perhaps one possibility would be to actually use Bayes factors between alternative topologies, because the most important problem that we have right now with those complex models is mixing problems but in tree space. And so if we can actually directly calculate the base factor between alternative reasonable topologies, I think it provides a good complementary approach. That's something that has been actually proposed by Jeremy Brown in another context recently, calculating base factors among alternative topologies. And that's what I'm developing now in Phylobase.
I don't totally understand. So, I mean, it sounds very interesting, and I don't actually know the paper you're referring to, but So I understand we can calculate base factors. You're talking about base factors for topologies?
Yeah, between alternative topologies. So you could directly calculate the base factors between Tino-4 sister and Sponge sister in the present case. And directly,
you know, look at how would that help with efficiency?
With efficiency, or at least because, well, perhaps you just need to spend some computational resource on the problem. But then another problem, so it takes time in any case, but then in some situations, you can run for a long time, and then you still get like discrepancies between independent chains that don't seem to decrease with time. And so in those situations, you just don't know how much time you would need. Whereas if you use base factors, this will still be computationally expensive, but then you have a bounded amount of time that it will be used to actually calculate this base factor.
So okay.
You have a more practically usable framework.
Right. Yeah. Okay. I get it. I mean, I guess I just also sort of wonder, like, I don't know, maybe there's some way that one could combine results between subsets of the data, or I just saw an interesting paper by Tandy Wardo's group where they were thinking about ways that they could extend the use of BaliFi to larger data sets by basically sort of taking subsets of data and building a tree and alignment on that, and then extending that out to a larger set of data. I wonder if a strategy like that could work as well for Phylo Bayes.
Yeah, I think it could work. There are several ways you could implement that, actually. There are ways that would try to stay Bayesian, basically, by trying to combine different posterior distributions over a subset into a global posterior distribution. It is a bit challenging, but allowing for some approximations, it's not impossible. Or you could actually directly use jackknife methods and then use essentially phylobase as a way to make point estimates of the phylogeny on each of the jackknife replicates and then look at the jackknife distribution. We've done that several times, but then this means that you are essentially getting a frequentist jackknife sampling distribution using an estimator that happens to be Bayesian. So it's a two-level system that requires some justification theoretically. It's valid in principle, but it requires some justification and some validation. So that would be ways to do that.
So when you mention alternative statistical strategies, you mentioned Andrew's ideas. Do you have any other ideas in that direction?
Yes. Basically, I tend to view what Andrew was showing with those posterior mean estimates as a specific case of maximum penalized likelihood. And so I could imagine that we could make simple maximum penalized likelihood models and try it with those things in the present case. So basically try to maximize the likelihood with respect to the tree, the alpha parameter, and all of the profiles across sites, but with a penalization for not overfitting. And that's something that is used a lot in other fields of statistics today. I think most of statistics today in the frequentist domain is actually using those like high dimensional models, but with penalized likelihood systems. And that could definitely be explored in the present case.
That's interesting. Yeah, I mean, so that's an interesting sort of alternative to the full Bayesian strategy, but would allow you to have a fairly flexible set of parameters.
Right.
I'm guessing that you're putting together this new set of simulations for a publication, or is that just something you've been working on your own?
Oh, no, yes, that's definitely for a publication. That's something I would like to essentially get deeper into those things. And then try also, I haven't shown that, but I'm trying other cases, like the case of Gesinacea morphs. And try to see if I also reproduce those artifactual patterns. But definitely, this is for publication.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I haven't seen any other questions come up. So I guess we'll just have to say thank you very, very much. And that concludes this session of three talks. The next set of talks are going to be about bacteria and bacterial phylogenetics. We have a really interesting, oh, there was one more. Okay, I'll just finish what I was going to say and then we can continue to the next question.
Yeah.
We've got an exciting set of speakers. I'm going to start out with Laura Hug describing this big new group of bacteria that have been recently discovered through direct sequencing of soil samples. Hello. He says, I guess Nicola addressed this already a little bit, but I'd be interested in his interpretation of figure 5 and Whalen's cat out of the bag paper, the figure where he shows an increasing number of occupied categories under cat as the size of the data set increases.
Yeah, so that's a point actually. If you think in terms of number of occupied categories, so number of site classes as an estimate, there is a confusion here between the number of components in the population and the number of site classes in your sample, basically. And the CAT and the CAT GTR models give you an increasing number of components as the data set increases in size. Now, this is, at least in the context of complex distributions, what I've shown, like using this mixture of Dirichlet densities, this is actually an expected behavior of the Dirichlet process method, because this is precisely the way, you see, if you want to have an asymptotically consistent estimation of an unknown distribution, and if this distribution is continuous, then you can approximate this distribution increasingly accurately only by increasing the number of components. that's the way you can achieve a synthetic consistency. So in itself, it's not, I don't think it's a problem. And again, I mean, if you look at the implied distribution, which can be easily visualized in terms of the continuous distribution function, you see that, in fact, this is just a question of, like, introducing redundancy in your distribution, but otherwise, this doesn't change anything in the situation where you have a finite mixture. I don't know if this addresses the point, but...
Yeah, that makes sense to me. Yeah, I mean, it sounds like maybe that's also something that you can address in the paper.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thanks again. And
Thank you.
The recording will be up right away. All right. Thanks again.